Hello everybody and welcome to the post-lunch session. I don't see sleepy faces. That's good. So the talk is extending Android with new devices, and we'll show how you can support a joystick and a barcode scanner with Android. Okay. Before I go ahead, a quick intro. My name is Shree Kumar. I like to be called Shree. I work at Innovine Software. We make devices which are Android enabled. And I blog at my website shreekumar.in. I'm more of an adventurer. So if you want to see some cycling stories, you can Google for Shree Kumar and cycle, so you can find some. And
so, hey guys, I'm Nitheesh. I'm an engineering student, computer science, from BS Institute of Technology, Bangalore. So,
yeah. So with that, let's just start off with these slides. Right, so what are we doing? I don't know if any of you attended the talk by Texas Instruments yesterday. So that was about how they expect Android to be used in a lot of scenarios, not just netbooks, tablets, and mobile phones. Right, so Android is expected to proliferate, and that's way beyond just the traditional Android strengths. So at least that's what people are expecting and betting on, right? So if you're going to have to go to new areas of application, you will invariably end up having to support new devices. So yesterday one example was some washing machine or something like that, right? What does a washing machine have? Perhaps some motors, right? And then there will be applications running on top of that. They will need to use the motor. So there's new devices and new APIs. Next. Okay. So with that background, what are we going to do in this talk? So a quick look at it. So we'll first have a look at how devices are supported in Linux. So this is important because Android is at heart a Linux kernel with modifications. Right. Then we'll jump into what our layered approach is for supporting new devices. So we have a layered approach identified, and we'll go through that. Then we'll give you the two examples that we're talking about, the joystick and the industrial barcode scanner. And bear in mind that all these things are, all this talk is from a device maker's perspective. So there's typically a need for faster time to market. And the other thing is compatibility with the Android market. So Android devices are very popular because same applications run on multiple devices, right? So keeping that compatibility is very important. And so we'll try to keep these two things in mind. Next slide. So how are the devices supported in Linux? So this is just a quick layer view. So you have the device. You have the Linux kernel on top of it. Right? Linux kernel has all the drivers that are needed, and if a device is detected, device nodes corresponding to that are created. And there's typically a privileged daemon of some sort, right, for every kind of device, which has access to the device node. So either the permissions of the device node are managed, or the daemon is running as root, one of the two. So if the permissions of the device node are managed, then that is done through UDEV. So if there are any Linux-based Android developers here, you would have added etc udev rules.d51 Android rules, this file. This gives you access, being a regular user, to the ADB functionality, which is running over USB. Okay. The privileged daemon just set UID or set GID. On top of that, you typically have a device API. And finally comes the user app, which interacts with the device API and gives you what you want. Next slide. So what's our Android approach? So Android is at heart a Linux kernel, as I was talking earlier. But it has a very different user space. Okay. There's no UDEV, all the regular services are all very done in a very different fashion. But the underlying thing is Linux kernel. Okay. So we start from there and we build a layered approach all the way to the user application, which is running on Java. Okay, so we start from the kernel, from the device and the kernel. So typically the kernel won't have the required device drivers for the kind of devices you want to support. So Linux kernel has a lot of drivers, right? But Android will typically have something which is very, very stripped down. So you may want to add device drivers there. And that would give you the device node, which the upper layers need. So from a service point of view, we use a JNI interface to tap into the device node, okay? And device permissions are managed by another daemon, not actually daemon, it's something else. It's called UEventD in Android. So if you go to older versions of Android, you will not really find UEventD. But Gingerbread and above have UEventD. So this is basically a very stripped down UDEV kind of environment. And that has the effect equivalent to giving a particular app ownership, a particular user or group ownership of the device. So after that, you run your services, which are on Java, which use the JNI interface to talk to the device. So the service should be running at the right permissions with, as the right user. So if you're an Android app developer, you know that apps run at user IDs 10,000 and higher. Like you do PS on an Android system, you see app underscore something something. Right? So all those are non-privileged users. And they will interact via IPC with the service which is running as a system user or some other user and finally give you the required functionality. Okay. And one thing we have done here is that we use a platform library approach. So what's a platform library? Basically what happened is platform library is a way for device manufacturers to have device manufacturers have their own specific pieces. Okay. And so once you have a platform library, applications can be built which have a dependency on the platform library, and market will actually do the filtering based on that. So people who don't have specific functionality, they will not see your device when it's searched for in the market. When they search for device in the market, if there's an app which needs a particular functionality, it will be visible only on those devices. So, nice. So what's the first example that we have? Supporting a USB joystick. Why did we choose this device? So we have a student working with us as an intern, right? So we took him a simple example, so we started off with that, and he chose this device because he had it. So we would play games with it, so he started off with it. And our attempt is to map concepts to details. So we already shown you a quick layering. And this is actually a very minimalistic requirement for this kind of device because it's a USB device. So you only need a system with Android USB host capability. Okay. So with that, I want to give it to Nitheesh.
So hey guys, I'm explaining about steps that's involved in providing support for the USB. So I kind of wonder that it would be nice if I could show you the example first, the application that I've developed for the USB. And then I could map the same concept so that you'll understand the kind of layered overview. So that's what I'll try to do. So first show the application, and then I'll talk the concepts through about that. Okay. So
we have an Android x86 running on this.
So yeah, what we have here is Android x86 running on our laptop. So we don't have a normal ARM-based system, it's an x86-based system. So I've installed a Froyo on top of my laptop. And let me start my application, okay? So yeah, I hope you can see. I know the last part is cut out, but that's how my keyboard joystick looks like. So if you can see, it's a Logitech Precision gamepad, which is a 10-key gamepad, right? So the simple application that I have here is I just start, and then you can see the buttons coming up, right? Look at that. So you have all your buttons there. You are able to see those red dots there, right? So that's when I click my buttons, right? So that's what's happening on the UI. So this is a simple application which I did. You can take it to any other levels that you want, create a game out of it, or pretty much anything that you get from it. So I'll explain you to the concept that we can go with this. So switching back to the slides. So the step one. So that part on that corner will tell you what layer of the Android framework that we are modifying at individual steps, right? So the first part, you can see the device. You don't have to do much with the device. The device is already ready, so you can just start utilizing it. The next part that we'll have to work with is the kernel. So the kernel comes preloaded with the HID raw device drivers. That's what your joystick uses. So we don't have to do much with the device drivers manipulation there. All you have to do is boot up and check if it comes out as one of your input subsystem device nodes. So that node you would preferably get it in the this file structure there, slash dev slash input slash event x. X could be 1, 2, any of the numbers there. So you can do a small regular expression and find out that mine is the last equation game part which has event 15. That's how it turned out in my system over there. So this is your first step, how it goes about. So now that your kernel knows how to talk with your device, the next step you would have to do is communicate with the device node itself. So how would you go about with Android? So you have your JNI interface where you can write your native code. So the first thing that you do is write a normal C code which can actually talk to your device itself, right? So the file, we identify that it's slash dev slash input slash event 15. So the first step that you do is reopen that file and start reading events from it. So it's as simple as open up that device in read-only mode and then start reading from the device. If you can see, the key part over here is the event structure. If you can see that. This structure, this is a struct input underscore event. Now this maintains your key mapping itself. The important part in that structure is the scan code and the value that you get. The scan code represents uniquely represents your individual button in the key joystick, and then the value for key down or key up. So that's what we'll have to do with it. So that's the basic step, and then you would provide a JNI wrapper around the code itself. So if you attended the talks yesterday, one of the last JNI talks, so there was a requirement of the JNI onload where you register all your native methods. So this is a simple structure which registers the method there.
Just for those who don't know JNI, so that's the way in which you access, which you run native code from Java. So you basically write native code, write wrappers around it, and the JVM loads that native code and can execute it like a class method in a Java class.
Right, so in my JNI code, I just have three simple functions, right? So if you can see, it's joystick open, joystick get key, and joystick close. So that's the three primitive functions that you would need to communicate with the device. What you'll be doing with your JNI device is in the end, you'll generate a shared library, which will be used by your Java code itself. So that's with the JNI stuff.
The JNI onload function there is used to register the methods. When the VM loads the shared library, then it will call JNI onload. So there we register our methods.
So that part of JNI wrapping is done. So the next thing is that now you have a JNI code that can communicate with the device. But if you see slash dev slash input has root permissions, so you need require your app to have permissions to access the device. Next thing that you would do is, like she talked about, you have UEMD that manages the permissions for your device nodes. So you would have to go and change your permissions. So what I've done here is, I've changed my input device permissions to AID underscore system. That's Android username system, which has access to most of the Android features there.
Well, Nitheesh didn't talk about it. System core init devices.c. So this is all part of the Android source code. Okay, so here we are actually modifying the Android source code itself specific to this device and changing the permissions of a device node so that that node can be used with the daemons that we are going to run next.
So that's the part for the flow. If you are using Gingerbread and above, you have UND.rc, which is that. Now that you have permissions, that was the next step, that you had permissions to access the device. Now you know your kernel can communicate with the device. Now you have your native code that can interact and interpret the messages from your device, and you have permission to access it. The next thing is that you will have to make all of them available for your application programmer to have it. Your application should be able to access it. So that's where the services comes into picture. So what you, the structure that you see over here is, this is all my JNI code, which actually talks about native applications, which access my device. And then here is my service. Now my service uses my native features to access my device and provide the same features to top level of my application. So what my service uses is the joystick API, as you can see, and joystick callback. Now both of them are interfaces, AIDL interfaces. So I don't know if you guys attended the Shree's talk yesterday on AIDL services. So where he explained what kind of those interfaces were, just an interface to the service where the applications can interact with the interface. Here I was telling you my all of them are my native codes, and then here's my service that uses my native codes and then makes the same thing available to my application on top. And then these are my interfaces which the application can use to talk with the service, right? Okay, Shree, you can go to the next. The service that you create, since it's accessing the device, it needs to be have permissions, special kind of permission. So here you certify your service saying that with your local certificate platform, so using that. And then you will also, since you're creating your own kind of device and service, that you will have to create a permission of your own. So that's what is over here. Say when you say permission Android name of com sample use underscore joystick. So your applications, when it uses the service, will have to use permission of that permission. So that's the permission that's being created over here. So this is the next step where your service will take permissions. And So this is where the inter-process communication between the service and the app takes place. So I'm running a little bit fast since we wasted a little bit more time there. Your service uses this interface to provide, as I said, service to the application. So this is what has happened. So your joystick API is nothing but has two methods, set callback and clear callback. So whenever there's a key press, your application can set a callback. I mean, what has to happen when that key is triggered? That's what takes place over there. And then this is what happens in the service place. In your service, you create a new API every time there's an application that's binded to the service, and you put in your logic over here. What has to happen during the callback? That's what's supposed over here place, right? So this gives you a kind of idea about what's happening in the service, right? Okay. So here we come back to the platform library. So as Shree told, it's kind of a feature that Google came up for the OEMs to provide support without modifying the Android framework. So you'll have to have your platform library of your own. So when your application uses platform library and then you're downloading applications from Android market, only if you have this support will that be available for you. So in order to have this platform library, there's a small thing that you'll have to do. So you'll have to have an XML file that declares your library, and you have to put up in your /system/etc/permissions directly. So that notifies the Android framework that you're having a platform library of your own. So the output of this platform library is not an APK file. So that's what here is. So it's a normal jar file containing all the features and the services and the interfaces that the application is going to use. So that's the output of that file. So I'll tell you where this will be used during the application program. Now that you have your the kernel part is done, the GNI part is done, and you have permissions with the UMD, and you have your service up. Now the next thing is that how does the application use this service to start interacting with the device, right? So the first thing you do is bind to the service that we created previously. That's the same thing as what we said there. So joystick service, that's the service that the first thing you do. The application binds to the service. Then when the service is connected, right? So that's when your service says that it's been connected to your application, then you create a new API. So this is where you create a new API. Right? So this is the means of communication between the app and the service. So once your service is connected, you say API.setCallback of your callback function. So if the service knows that anytime there's an event, key event happens, that this callback is going to get called over there. So this is the basic structure of how your application looks like. The next thing is the callback itself. What happens in the callback? This is the function that has to be defined by the application. So every time the callback gets done, you have to do your logic code over that. So what I'm doing is just updating my UI. And since the Android UI library is not thread safe, you have to run your UIs on the UI thread itself, or you can use the async task to do the same thing. So every time there is a key event that happens over there, I get the key back from here. So if you see on key press int R0, the R0 gives me what was the scan code that was clicked over there. So I get the scan code and I update my UI with respect to the scan code. That's what is happening over there. So now you're clear with the usual steps that take place to just come up till over here, right? So that's part with the application. So I previously told you that with the platform library you get a jar file. Now this is where it's being used. So how would your application know, what does your application have to import to access those services, that joystick service and joystick interface? So this is the Java library that you'll be using. So in your Eclipse, if you're programming Android, you have to have your user library. That is the same library that was the output there. So that when you have that library included, you can start importing the packages, the service, joystick service, and the joystick callback and the joystick API interfaces. So that's when this comes into picture. Next thing is, it's all done, right? So now this is the overview that gives you what happens individually. So this is a small thing. So if we go through from first, so here is the application that first binds to the service. And inside the service, the onCreate method is called, where the joystick thread starts working. So I didn't show you the source code of the service, but since we're running short on time, so just abstract that, saying that there the worker thread starts off, and then it returns you a joystick API back to your application. My application instantiates the service, and then that's how it can talk with your service running internally. So when you set a callback, you'll again go back to the joystick service, and then that's where your worker thread starts. So you start up pulling your device, asking for, is there any events that's generated from the key. So anytime there is an event generated, a key, you get a key, and that key is sent back to your application. Your application then updates your UI based on the key. And that's how the complete workflow goes around with it. So that's pretty much basic about how you can interface with the joystick. You know, it's kind of a little bit abstract, but if you need more information, so you can just contact us after the session. So we'll be glad to help you with that.
So any questions till this point? We'll take a question or two. Okay. So I think then we'll go back. So Nitheesh has actually covered what happens with the joystick completely. Next. Right, so our second example is a barcode scanner. In our case, we have chosen the Opticon MDI-2300. This is a very engineering description. So the company that makes this is Opticon, and they actually make a module. So this is actually a development board, okay, which has the scanner module, which is here, and the image processing module, which is here, okay. This is mostly a development board, which has all interfacing and everything, okay. So, first thing you may ask me is, why do you want to use a dedicated device, right? Everybody knows that there's an Android barcode scanning application in it. Everybody asks me why we need a dedicated scanning device, right? So, a final dedicated scanning device may look like this. So, this is the Honeywell X1900, okay? So, why do you want to have that? Because, first, it supports a ton of symbologies. So that means that it can decode barcodes of a lot of type. So as you can see on that right side, there are lots of types of barcodes. So this thing can scan and convert about 46 types of barcodes and a lot of subcategories inside that. Whereas the ZXing library, which you perhaps see on your Android phone, that can only support a few. And some of them, as you can see, are alpha quality. So people, when they want to use barcode scanners, they want absolute reliability. They don't want somebody just walking around and decoding barcodes one at a time, very slowly, with the autofocus of the camera working and all that. Okay. So a real barcode scanner device is typically very fast. It has other features like a very long cable, okay, illumination, the red light that you see. So all these are very industrial features. So it's not the same thing as you going to a bookshop and you're scanning a barcode and trying to figure out what this thing is. So that's what ZXing is primarily meant for. And the last thing would you really drop your smartphone?
Right? So, you have this, right? I wouldn't drop my stick, not long enough. Right? Nothing happens to the barcode scanner. Okay? So,
real world applications need reliability, not features. Okay. Yeah, next slide. So, the first thing about the barcode scanners is they're very different than the kind of devices that you're typically used to. Okay, so to get the barcode scanner to work, you typically scan barcodes. Okay, that's one of the interesting things. So this particular Opticon barcode scanner, there's a website called opticonfigure.opticon.com. You can actually go there, select some menus, save that, generate a PDF file, scan that, and the barcode scanner will be configured. So that's how they work. So they are very specific purpose-built devices. Okay, and the barcode, the actual barcode should scan vary on the device. So don't try this on your supermarket. Okay, so before I can go ahead, I think we will have a quick demo of how this whole thing works. Right?
The application
is running. So we'll start from the beginning. So this is Android again. Okay, and I hope it will work. So we have done some hard coding. The kernel level for certain things to simplify coding. So this is the application which you go and run, and it's waiting for barcode scanning to start. Okay, these are all minimalistic applications, right? Just to illustrate concepts. So you have the barcode scanner here, okay, and you need real barcode. So I have a sample barcode sheet here. So I'll just scan one of these. Right, so you got a value there, right? And of course, at this point, you just have to believe me that it's the same as that, because all the work is being done by the device, right? So, barcodes are used for a variety of purposes. So, for example, in our office, we have ID cards with barcodes in the back, which encode an employee ID. So, this is just a simple demo switch. Okay, so now let's go and have a look at the internal. So, barcode scan is at heart a very simple device, right? There's not much to do. When you shoot, you get a barcode, right? Everything else is application logic, and we are just talking about just the system implementation. So we're going to restrict ourselves to that. So the first thing that you need to do, the USB device that we talked about earlier, the joystick, it had drivers inside the kernel, Android kernel. Okay. So this one doesn't. It needs a CDC ACM device driver, and typically the next kernel will have it. It would be disabled in the Android config build, kernel build. So you have to enable that. Sometimes it will so happen that the kernel tree on which Android is based might be somewhat dated, so you might have to take the latest changes. So these devices are USB based, so they typically don't have a direct dependency in the hardware, they have a dependency in the protocol. So the protocol is going to work mostly irrespective of the kind of Linux version that you have. So you just have to find the newest driver with the latest patches. If you see that something is not working. So you find the Linux kernel which supports your device, let's say your desktop, you try out your scanner, you come to Android, you enable the configuration options. Boom, it's all ready. Okay. So what you need to do may be dependent on the exact kernel that you have. So the, on the kernel that I'm experimenting with, I needed to add a few lines to the driver so that it could actually recognize this device, this particular Opticon module. So after you make those changes, you should typically boot your device with the device plugged in and check that it's really supported. See if it's really interacting. Okay. Yeah. So how would you interface with the device? Now you have the device running, the kernel is ready, you can actually interact with the device. So again, we adopt the same method. We write some C code, which can actually go and look at that device now. So typically when you plug in a barcode scanner, it will show up as /dev/TTY/SM0. Of course, this is not very hard-coded. Right? So in reality, what may happen is that the device node number may change. You will have to go and read through dev to figure out which exact device it is. You have to look at the USB VID and PID, vendor ID and product ID, to figure out that it's the right device. Okay. But for now, that's enough. So barcode scan is a very simple device. So you open the device node, you will typically get one line per every barcode scan. Okay. So this again is a simplification. But you would typically, for typical barcodes, you would get one line per barcode scanned. They are all delimited by a new line. Okay. So much simpler, right? I think it will get simpler. Right? So we just wrap it around using some native code, put some JNI on it. But again, we hit the same problem. Mistake in the slides. I used the wrong thing. So /dev/TTY/SM0, the node, it will not have permissions to. It will have permissions to root, it will not have permissions to any other process. Okay, so we will not be able to use it directly. So, what we really need to do is we need to fix /dev/TTY/SM and a shortcut to make it working is to make the owner system. Okay, so there is a file called und.rc which controls, as I was saying earlier, what permissions are assigned to a device. So, we can go and say /dev/TTY/SM 0660, that is read write permissions to system and root. So owner is system and group is root. Okay. And then any process which is executing as android.uid.system. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So any process which is executing as android.uid.system will be able to access the device. Okay. There's an alternate method. You always talk about Android compatibility. Android has strict compatibility requirements, which means that we can't alter the API. But in the manifest file, you have shared user ID. So one method that I have found is that you can define your own shared user IDs with which you can give any permissions that you really want. So this line here actually assigns, if you use com.sample.uid.acm inside your manifest file, that will map to the user ID USB. So 1018 is the number for USB. Okay, so it's very simple to do. This does not break compatibility and provides you a way to run applications with any permissions you want. Okay, so again, the API for barcode scan is very simple. You just scan barcode, you register a callback. It's exactly the same thing as that. So we won't discuss this more. Of course, you have to sign your APK using you have to set up your APK with android.uid.system and you have to sign the APK with the platform key. Okay, application interface is also pretty simple, that just like what I showed you. Okay, so I think we could quickly come to the end of this talk. So a summary of what we discussed till now. Important steps in enabling a new device. Okay, we gave you two examples which I kept simple on purpose. Just illustrative of samples. We skipped a few things, like we didn't talk about power management. We didn't talk about deeper system integration. So we made services which are independent of everything else. That's not the way most of Android works, but this keeps the concept very separate. So if you are the device maker, you can actually tamper with system server and add the services that you want directly there. Okay? So that we come to the end of our talk. Any questions? We will have time for one. One question. Is there any questions? Oh, okay, none. Okay, so thank you very much for attending. I hope it was useful.